Welcome to our service of praise, prayer and reflection for Sunday the 19th of April. We begin with the well-known hymn, Morning Has Broken. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the beauties of earth and sky, hill and valley, field and garden. We thank you for the kiss of sunlight and warmth on barren earth, and all the fresh new growth that springs to life. You are a great Creator God, and we see the evidences of that all about us. We would praise you with all our hearts for this world you have placed us in, a world which displays so much evidence of your love and care, but which humankind has so often spoilt and abused, especially in our own generation. Help us to be faithful stewards of what you have given into our care, working with you rather than against you, and letting love govern all our actions. We thank you that you are not a God who has left us on our own to get on with life outside your active presence. You have drawn near to us in Christ, and through him you have sent your Spirit to indwell our lives and fill us with a sense of your presence and your power and your love. Today we come before you in our own homes as your people to worship you, to give you a place in our lives and the life of our community, in quietness to focus our minds on eternal realities, in joy and wonder to remind ourselves of the depth of your love for us. For we serve a risen Saviour. You, our Lord, went the way of the cross to lift the burden from our backs, to set us free from all that drags us down, and open for us a new and living way into the presence of the Father. We ask your forgiveness for the ways we have failed you and failed others, and pray that in your love you would cleanse us and help us to find a more faithful and loving way forward. We praise you, Lord, that you defeated sin and death and reign in heaven above. Reign in our lives also, Lord, and awaken in us a new devotion and love of you, which will lead us out to love and serve others you have placed around us. We would say in the words that you gave to us, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever. Amen. Our reading today is taken from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, reading from verses 12 to 45, which is read from the New International Version. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, What are you discussing together as you walk along? They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days? What things? He asked. About Jesus of Nazareth, they replied. He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see Jesus. He said to them, How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going further. But they urged him strongly, Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over. So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us? They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon. Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures.
From you, your knowledge of me is so deep, you surround me on every side, and before I open my mouth, you know what I will say. Where could I go to get away from your touch? Neither you alone.
Our reading from the Gospel of Luke began on the road to Emmaus. It was still the same day that some of the women and the disciples had found the garden tomb empty. It was the same day that Jesus had appeared to Mary Magdalene in the garden, and he now joined two disciples as they headed home to their rural village, full of despondency. Only one of them, Cleopas, is named, and it is often assumed that the other one was a man also. But they encouraged him to stay with them for the night because the day was nearly over. And to my mind, that makes it far more likely that this was a couple, husband and wife, who were followers of Jesus. Maybe a hint that there were far more women amongst his followers than we often realize. This is a story about two followers of Jesus who feel desperately let down. We find them trudging along the road to Emmaus after a shocking weekend. On the Friday, their friend and master, Jesus, the one on whom they had pinned all their hopes, had been executed. And now they and their friends fear that they are wanted criminals as associates of their crucified Lord. All their hopes had been dashed, not so much by the government, nor by the people, but by Jesus himself. Or at least, that was how it seemed. And sometimes that's how it can feel for us. Our hopes are dashed. We feel let down by others, by life, or by God. And we wonder who we can trust, where we will find an anchor that will not fail us, where we can pin our hopes so that they will not be dashed. And in this passage, Luke makes it very clear. There is only one who is totally trustworthy, and that is God himself. And time and again, we need to return to these wonderful truths to refresh our weary souls. In our world that is so often baffling and painful, we need to be reminded of these truths in the Bible, which give us hope and strength. And today, the truth we see is that there is one who will never let us down, even though his ways are often difficult to fathom. Because what these two travelers discovered on that Sunday afternoon was that they had been totally wrong in their estimation of Jesus. We meet them on their way home to Emmaus, deep in conversation, talking about the events of that weekend. It had been a very traumatic time for the disciples, and no doubt there was much to talk about. And as they talked, Jesus drew alongside them. But Luke tells us they didn't recognize him. Perhaps because they were so wrapped up in conversation, but more likely because in some way a veil was drawn across their eyes and God kept them from really seeing Jesus and recognizing him. Just as an aside, it's a lovely moment in the Gospels to see Jesus walking with these disciples at their lowest time. It also has a smack of authenticity. If we were making the story up, we'd probably have the disciples recognizing Jesus immediately and quickly coming to an understanding that he had risen from the dead and all the implications arising out of that. But that's not how it happened. Instead, he walks with them in their grief and trouble. And only gradually there comes to them a dawning realization that there was a different way of understanding all that they had been through and all that had happened to Jesus. And in hindsight, they were able to look back and remember how their hearts had burned within them as he talked with them on the road. He had sustained them at their lowest hour and brought a dawning awareness of a different reality. In the same way, Jesus will walk with us in the dark valleys that we go through from time to time, so that looking back afterwards, we will be able to see his comforting and sustaining hand and see how he lightened the burden on our backs and perhaps helped us see things in a different light. When Jesus asked these two disciples what they were talking about, it stops them in their tracks. And the gist of Cleopas' response is, "Where have you been, man? Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who hasn't heard about what's happened?" Clearly, everyone was talking about Jesus and what had happened to him. And Cleopas goes on, "We had our hopes pinned on him. He was everything to us, a great prophet and very powerful. And he went and got himself killed. Our hopes were raised briefly this morning. Some of our more excitable women went to the tomb and couldn't find his body. They claimed to have met angels who told them Jesus was alive. But when some of our companions went to the tomb, there were no angels, though they couldn't find the body. Somebody must be playing a cruel trick on us. We've had enough of all this. We're just heading home to get on with our lives after such a disappointing end to our dreams. Maybe we, like them, have felt let down by God at times." But Jesus went on to rebuke them and show them how they had misunderstood God's promises. And he began to open up the scriptures of the Old Testament to them. The risen Christ returned from the glory of heaven, and the first thing he did was endorse the Old Testament scriptures and reveal how they spoke about him in so many places. The risen Christ is telling us here that who he is and what he has done is the key to understanding the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms. Christ is found in the first five books of the Bible. He is the ark by which his people are saved. He is the tabernacle and the high priest and the sacrifices. The rock out of which water gushed in the wilderness is Christ. He is the bronze serpent set up high on a pole which men looked to and were healed. He is the scapegoat. He is the suffering servant Joseph, an innocent man condemned but vindicated and exalted by God. Christ is found in the prophets. Isaiah saw him high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple, and the angels covered their eyes before him and cried, "Holy, holy, holy." That prophet said a virgin would conceive and bear a son. He said his name would be Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. But he also said that he would be pierced for our transgressions and crushed for our iniquities, and the Lord would lay on him the sin of us all. He is the suffering servant of the Book of Psalms. He is the one who says in Psalm 22, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" He is the shepherd who is spoken of in Psalm 23, so that when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, he promises to be with us and comfort us. The Old Testament is all about the coming Christ. It is preparatory and prophetic. It builds up to his appearing. They got to Emmaus, and Jesus accepted their invitation to stay the night with them. And it was as Jesus broke bread at the table with them that their eyes were suddenly opened, and they recognized him. And then he suddenly disappeared from their sight. Despite the late hour, they dashed back to Jerusalem and found the disciples and other followers of Jesus. As they were excitedly sharing stories of Jesus' appearance to a number of them, Jesus suddenly appeared amongst them and said, "Peace be with you." He confirmed he was not a ghost, but a living, breathing man. Then he again opened their minds so that they might understand the scriptures and the real reason why he came. Jesus declared that God was very much in all the events of his life that had taken place. He went through all of it for them and for us, if we would only have minds and hearts open to see it. He doesn't promise that we will always have an easy life, a life without difficulty or suffering. But he does promise he will never leave us. He does promise he will forgive us and shine his light upon us to deal with all the darkness within us, and then walk with us on life's journey. It is as we read God's word in the Bible that we can meet Jesus, and God is able to open the eyes of our hearts and do a transforming work within us. May our hearts burn within us as we meet the risen Christ in that word.
I wanna see you. want to see you.
Lord, we would still our hearts in your presence. We would seek your blessing upon our lives at this time. We would seek your blessing upon our world in this time of crisis and uncertainty. We ask you to protect us from the spread of the coronavirus. We remember those living in coronavirus hotspots and those currently in isolation. May they know your presence in their isolation, your peace in their turmoil, and your patience in their waiting. Prince of Peace, you are strong and merciful. We pray for those who are grieving, reeling from the sudden loss of loved ones. May they find your comfort in their loss and your hope in their despair. We pray for all medical professionals dealing daily with the intense pressures of this crisis. Grant them resilience in weariness, discernment in diagnosis, and compassion upon compassion as they care. We thank you too for the army of researchers working steadily and quietly towards a cure. Give them understanding and clarity of mind, and help them towards a breakthrough. God of all wisdom, we pray for our leaders, the World Health Organization, national governments, and local leaders too. We ask you to grant them wisdom beyond their own wisdom to contain this virus, faith beyond their own faith to rise above fear, and strength beyond their own strength to sustain vital institutions through this time of turmoil. And we pray for all those who are filled with anxiety over the future of their businesses and their jobs. Sustain them in their times of need. And we pray for the protection of their livelihoods in the coming days. We pray for those facing conflict in their home situations and those overwhelmed by despair as they face the future. May they know healing of the tensions within them, and your peace, even in the midst of the uncertainty of what the future holds. Amen. Thank you. rise to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face, the rains fall soft upon your fields, and until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen.